tonight. A lack of political will is being blamed for the lack of progress in efforts to get St. Lucia to decriminalize marijuana. OECS has looked toward Africa as a trade partner. The Ministry of Health appeals to more St. Lucians to donate blood, and a former chief medical officer calls on the authorities to institute a strategy to reduce accidents caused by drunk driving. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story. A lack of political will is being blamed for St. Lucia's failure to follow moves by other countries to decriminalize marijuana. A number of states in the U.S., including California and Colorado, have decriminalized non-medical marijuana. A few Caribbean countries, such as Puerto Rico, Antigua and Barbuda, Jamaica and Belize, have followed suit.
Puerto Rico, Antigua and Barbuda, Jamaica and Belize are just a few countries in the Caribbean where marijuana has been decriminalized. Canada is the latest country to be added to that list. Adults there will be able to carry a share up to 30 grams of legal marijuana in public. Adults there will be able to carry and share up to 30 grams of legal marijuana in public. They also will be allowed to cultivate up to 4 plants in their homes and to prepare various marijuana byproducts. Consumers are expected to purchase marijuana from regulated retail outlets. While locally, a number of individuals and organizations have been advocating for the decriminalization of marijuana, former Chief Medical Officer Dr. Stephen King says the lack of political will is hindering progress in that area.
Leaders lack the courage to do what is right. The science is clear. It would be a better regime, there'd be less harm to everybody, and there'd be enhanced benefits by improving the legal regime, such as what Canada has done. So what stops leaders, be it in the cabinet or wherever they are, what stops leaders from doing the right thing can only be, in my view, ignorance and what I would call petty politics. So pandering to ignorance.
Dr. King is encouraging local leaders to learn from Canada's example. The drug has been decriminalized as a way to help protect youth while keeping profits out of the hands of criminals.
By making the trade legal, you remove the revenues from criminal elements. Because right now, the criminalized cannabis trade, the revenues there fuel criminal elements, and government itself cannot benefit from the trade because you cannot recognize and tax an illegal trade. So government makes no benefit. If you make it a legal trade, what happens is that essentially government can benefit from taxation of that trade, and those revenues can be used not only to enhance the trade of cannabis, the proper trade and the regulation of cannabis, but also the health education to prevent people, especially young people, from using cannabis.
Dr. King is calling for consideration to be given to the scientific and medical data on the plant before making a decision.
If you look at the medical science, there's a reason for an improved regulatory regime for cannabis, to allow cannabis to be used legally for medicinal use and for allow cannabis to be produced and pharmaceuticals to be produced from cannabis for medicinal use. That's clear. From an economics point of view, it's also clear. If you legalize the trade, the growth and the production and the trade of cannabis and cannabis products, there's economic benefit to be gained from that. There are livelihoods that will be gained from having a legal trade.
In May, National Security Minister Senator Humanigil Francis indicated that before the government decides to go the route of decriminalization, there must be consultation with members of the public as well as the opposition party on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
OECS authorities are looking at the possibility of establishing trade relations with countries on the African continent. Ambassador Anthony Severin, who is head of international relations at the OECS Commission, broke the news during an appearance on Newsmaker Live last evening. Don Nicholas explains.
For example, Ambassador Sevre emphasized the need for OECS member states to consider establishing economic relations with non-traditional partners. They have been urged to expedite the process of developing an Africa strategy within the ambit of the resources that they have. This matter came up at the meeting of the OECS authority.
Certain decisions have been taken in terms of where next we go, for example, in terms of our relationship with Africa, how we move. We're going to have what we consider to be an Africa strategy where we're going to be establishing relations with a number of countries on the African mainland, as well as the African Union.
Ambassador Sevre admits that establishing an embassy in Africa will be very costly. He says OECS governments will be faced with the dilemma of balancing between such ventures and their country's immediate needs.
There are also questions of resources, whether there are resources that are available to do those kinds of things. For example, to establish an embassy on the African mainland is going to cost quite a lot of money. You're going to have to post staff over there. And so there are all these kinds of questions which governments find themselves having to balance between that and immediate needs at home. So there are all these issues which come into play.
Ambassador Sevre says it will require a lot of effort to see this venture come to fruition. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Ministry of Health continues to appeal to St. Lucians to donate blood. The appeal began on World Blood Donor Day on June the 14th. The day serves to thank voluntary, unpaid blood donors for their life-saving gifts of blood and to raise awareness of the need for regular blood donations to ensure the quality, safety, and availability of blood and blood products for patients in need. Miguel Morissette tells us more.
The St. Lucia Blood Bank is currently challenged with low blood supply and blood products. In this regard, the Ministry of Health and Wellness, by extension the Blood Bank, is making a special appeal to citizens to donate blood. Medical technologist Karen Louis said, individuals don't need a special reason to donate blood. Some persons give blood because they are asked by a friend. Some know that a family member might need blood someday, or some may just want to help others. She added, no matter the reason for the donation, the need is constant and the contribution is important for a healthy and reliable blood supply.
The most selfless act that someone can do is to donate blood for someone else. It might be your neighbor, it might be yourself, it might be a stranger. St. Lucia, we want to encourage you to be part of a blood donating society.
Louis said they are thankful for the donors that are regular and they encourage them to continue to donate blood. The blood donation is a simple four-step process: registration, medical history and mini physical, donation and refreshment. The process is safe, and the actual blood donation typically takes less than 10 to 12 minutes. Blood recipient Vanita Bruce gave her testimony.
I'm very happy to support the work of the blood bank. I had surgery at the end of January. Wow. And I expected to be home. It's selective surgery, and I expected to be home 3 days later. But through a catalog of events and complications, I had to receive blood and blood works. I ended up in ICU and life-threatening situation. And I actually had to receive maybe close to 40 pints of blood or blood components. And I'm very, very thankful for all the people who actually donated blood, came out and donated blood, because that was very critical to me being here today and feeling as strong as I do today. And really and truly, I want to thank everybody who was instrumental in helping me to get back on my feet. Today, I would encourage each and everyone to pass the message along about the importance of donating blood.
The average adult has about 10 pints of blood in his or her body. Roughly 1 pint is given during a donation. The blood bank invites persons to donate blood between the hours of 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Mondays to Friday at the Victoria Hospital, or feel free to visit the mobile blood bank. For further information, one can call the blood bank department at 452-5430. Give blood, share life. From the communication unit in the Ministry of Health, Miguel Morissette reporting.
In other news, Invest St. Lucia is initiating a startup incubator program designed to help potential entrepreneurs turn their business ideas into reality. The program will also help these businesses access regional and international markets. We hear more in this report.
Invest St. Lucia has been working with the public sector on a policy framework for startup businesses. Once the businesses are up and running, the organization moves into the accelerator stage where businesses get help to increase their scalability or their ability to expand beyond St. Lucia's shores. Their response to the call for micro-enterprises to indicate their interest in the venture was phenomenal. More than 40 businesses indicated their interest. They ranged from agro-processors to manufacturers and information technology businesses. The organizers have been in discussion with the entrepreneurship centers in Europe to solicit their assistance.
A businessman has a concept that he really needs to sort of materialize. So unless he has access to financing, unless he has access to certain support, it's really not going to happen for him, because he's underfunded, he doesn't have workspace. If he goes on the market to look for workspace, it's anywhere from $3 a square foot to $10 a square foot. It's almost prohibitive for him. So there's a need for a workspace. So in the incubation stage, what you have happening is nurturing these concepts to something material.
The support that Invest in Lucia is envisaging is a physical space, a physical facility to incubate and accelerate those incubatees, but also to provide mentorship, a robust framework, a robust policy framework to help support startups in this space.
The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture's Junior Achievement Program sought to target young entrepreneurs to engage in a get-in-the-ring competition where they get an opportunity to travel overseas to pitch their business ideas.
Invest St. Lucia joined the chamber and came up to Qashqai and to experience and to network and to see firsthand how startups, mentors, angel investors, policymakers come together in one exciting, fun working environment where those startups are given the opportunity to network with each other and to develop their product.
Participating businesses explained the benefits of the program.
EcoCarb.com, which is a one-stop shop solution to get you to go green by using solar technology. The thing about this platform is that it brings together all the stakeholders in the energy industry, from the utility company to the government to the installers and the maintenance people, to help you not only finance by using the banks and other financial institutions, but to design, install, and maintain your chosen solar technology.
The networking is very, very important, because we realize that some certain people are at the stage where they are because they don't only operate like, I'm a St. Lucian company, so I'm registered in St. Lucia, and that's just it. No. Some of them are registered in their country, but at the same time, they still have the same company registered in Europe. So if they go to Europe, they present themselves as an European company. Then they go back home, they present themselves as the local company. The base plant actually is at their local country, but they still access the funds within the Europe because they have a representative in Europe.
This, Mr. Easy says, gives businesses the opportunity to expand their horizons. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the DBS News World, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. An intense weather system is scheduled to pass through St. Lucia today, Thursday. How are you preparing for this weather system?
Well, as a health professional, I'm actually, my drains and my water supply, all of that have been checked. Also, my trees, I have none over my roof for sure. And also putting in place all my documents, like my passports and everything, all that have been checked, okay, in a secured area, yes.
Well, I wasn't ready as yet, but I will soon get myself ready.
But it's on, eh?
Yes, I knew about it.
You know about it?
Yes.
So tell me, stuff like what are you going to get yourself ready for?
Well, I will get things from tin stuffs, things like salted biscuits and things else like that. That's what. That's the most important, your torchlight, batteries.
Yeah, I start preparing for now, yeah.
How have you prepared?
No, I start buying groceries, you know, to put in place. Yeah, to put in place, like you have to buy candles. You don't know when the weather will be bad, so that will be in darkness and they'll take the current. So you have to put measure in place. So you
always prepared?
Yeah, I always prepared, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But here's a big question now. Are you prepared right now?
Yeah, I prepared right now. Because if the hurricane comes strong sometime, it can damage my roof and all kind of things. So I have to put all measures in place so that I know that my house will be safe for the hurricane season.
On peut s'espérer hurricane pour vous préparer. On est pour préparer avant ça. Because si hurricane n'a pas fait, c'est pas là où il y a l'argent pour nous préparer pour hurricane. On est pour faire quoi avant ça. Vous avec l'année chez bail qui calme pays il pas mon route.
Les hurricane là même.
Oui.
Hurricane la même, vous préparez pour ça.
Oui, on y prépare pour lui. Oui. Mais pas ça, c'était il vient pour préparer.
So,
on y pour préparer avant ça.
Ça
même qu'on capable, on y pour préparer là pour cao sini diasu ça ca c'est gars cher bon, toutes ces bagages là on y prépare. C'est pas espérer hurricane venir pour préparer bagage pour hurricane. Bon, de laisser hurricane n'a pas point. So, on y a dit là c'est là qu'il fait. Non, pas ça fait ça. On y prépare avant ça. Est-ce que non? On toujours préparé. On est pour faire préparation avant ça. C'est comme on est malade à ce qu'on ou bien ça se met à arriver malade là et pour préparer.
I didn't prepare for it, but God is in charge. God tell you, He will stop anything that coming. Because, I mean, the world is going on and the fullness of it.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Busquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a former chief medical officer calls on the authorities to institute a strategy to reduce accidents caused by drunk driving. And DBS Television and the Rotary Club team up to promote road safety. A former chief medical officer and the president of the St. Lucia Crisis Center are calling for authorities to think seriously about a strategy to reduce alcohol consumption as one way of lowering the number of road fatalities and domestic violence cases linked to drinking. Sheffield Gillard reports.
Former Chief Medical Officer Dr. Stephen King has attributed a number of violent incidents and road collisions to alcohol consumption. Left unchecked, he believes this has the potential of placing tremendous strain on an already overburdened health system.
Alcohol will fuel all violent behaviors as well as accidents because it impairs your judgment, it impairs your skills. So clearly alcohol is a major factor. I mean, and from the studies, as you know, that there are good 80 to 90% of St. Lucians that are going to use alcohol in some form or fashion, some more responsibly, some more irresponsibly than others. But the truth is, alcohol is a major problem. And so addressing issues of substance use and abuse in the communities is of paramount importance. And alcohol is the number one drug fueling poor public health and hurting the economy and the livelihoods of people.
Dr. King is of the opinion that there are simple solutions to the problem.
I'm unaware of any quantification of what the spend is, the money lost and the money spent related to alcohol induced issues. But guaranteed, if it is done, that toll would be very high, very high. And there's no doubt also that, in fact, interventions to reduce alcohol use are important. And those interventions are not difficult. The advertising has to stop. The promotion of alcohol has to stop. The getting youth in particular to understand how not to use alcohol, so that you can participate in social activities without alcohol is important. And of course, by extension, to get adults to do the same thing and to have that kind of behavior that they can mirror for the young people, so that we all know that alcohol can be put in a much better place in our society. So it is not abused in the manner in which it is right now.
The president of the St. Lucia Crisis Center, in agreeance with Dr. King, says the organization has had a number of domestic violence cases in which alcohol consumption played a major role.
Whenever there's drugs involved in anybody's life, there's the tendency, you know, for violence to escalate, you know. Of course, the crisis center is continually counseling people to be moderate in their intake of alcohol and, you know, that sort of stuff. But we really have to learn how to deal with issues, you know. You have a problem, you speak about it to the person in question, or you get help from somebody, a priest, a pastor, you know, a counselor, so that you can deal with the problem. Because anytime you speak about a problem, the problems become a little lighter. But when you allow it to fester, then it blows up. And sometimes at the time you least expect, you have a full-blown incident, you know.
Mr. Lambert joins Dr. King in calling for a campaign to discourage excessive alcohol consumption.
From the statistics way back, St. Lucia was actually consuming 4/5 of the amount of products that the other OECS islands were actually producing. So out of 5/5, we were actually consuming 4/5. So it shows, you know, that we have a problem in St. Lucia. But we have to look at all of these factors, you know. Sometimes people drink because they are unemployed. Sometimes people drink because of family problems, you know. So it's a multitude of factors that actually cause that.
Alcohol is the most commonly used drug worldwide. For the DBS News World, I'm Sheffield Gillard.
The Rotary Club of Groseley has partnered with the number one television station on the island to undertake an intensive road safety campaign aimed at curbing the number of collisions on the nation's roads. Traffic police have reported a steady increase in the number of accidents in the last few years. We hear more from Sheffield Gillard.
The Rotary Club, in collaboration with Dire Broadcasting Service, DBS, has produced a series of road safety videos. The club, having celebrated its 25th anniversary on March 5th, decided to celebrate the milestone with a legacy project around the subject of road safety. With 10 road fatalities recorded so far for 2018, the idea seemed like a good one.
The statistics will show that young people, particularly male, from 17 to say 25, are those predominantly involved in road crashes, whether on motorcycles or whether in cars. And so we hope that the ad will draw them in to get the message that really they need to be aware of the laws in St. Lucia as far as it regards driving safely on the road. For example, not overtaking around the corner, wearing a seatbelt, and there are specific things that you do if you own a motorcycle in terms of how you use the road that we want to draw people's attention to.
DBS Television was the title sponsors for the 2016 Rotary Club of Groseley Golf Tournament. The organization uses the funds from the tournament to undertake its various programs. DBS has decided to partner with the club to undertake the project.
It's very important for us to be part of this campaign because it's very relevant to a lot of things happening today. Of course, everybody is aware and can see for themselves the amount of road accidents that we've been having, and many of them being fatal. So us here at DBS, being news carriers, of course, we cover these stories. It's always saddening. And then, of course, just alarming the rate of accidents that we're having. So when we heard of this campaign, it was only fitting to be part of that to help push the awareness and, of course, encouraging our fellow St. Lucians to, you know, drive safe, be smart, and drive safe.
The campaign will also focus on excessive consumption of alcohol.
In St. Lucia, what the statistics will show is that young people will consume alcohol and they will drive. So it isn't that alcohol by itself is the issue or that cars by themselves is an issue, but the two together It's the heavy intoxication and sitting behind a wheel. A young man gets a certain amount of power from doing that, and they will drive faster than they should. And essentially, the vehicles get out of control, and a crash occurs, which takes a life. So we thought combining the two really is the way to go, so that not to focus on just the alcohol, but certainly alcohol consumption, which occurs during a show, and there are many shows in St. Lucia, more now than before. So the alcohol consumption during a show, we found that accidents occur after the shows, after midnight, between the show ending at midnight and getting home, when they're driving home. And so really the focus is, it has to be on vehicle, management of the vehicle under the influence, which causes the crash.
The 1 minute and 17 second ad will be aired starting this week and will run for 6 months over mainstream media in addition to social media. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Tomorrow, Dr. Harvey Miller, Solution Management Consultant and Professor at St. Mary's University in Nova Scotia, Canada, will lead the St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce discussion on human resource development in a power breakfast setting. Leaders, key decision makers, and human resource managers and professionals will participate in this enlightening forum, where Dr. Miller will seek to get them to connect with some powerful and provocative ideas on maximizing your return on human resources. Dr. Miller will table some concepts to challenge the traditional thinking about catapulting human resources to achieve greater and better performances, and lead a discussion among the HR managers of some of St. Lucia's largest and also most progressive firms. He will introduce and suggest an HR excellence model, also known as HREM, which will allow firms to take a systems approach to building an HR infrastructure. The two-hour session has been specifically designed to be brief, sharp, and practical. At the end of this powerful breakfast discussion, the hope is that participants will be inspired to look at HR through an enhanced lens and commit to making the kinds of improvements that will maximize their return on their HR investment. The event starts at 8 o'clock in the morning at the Coco Palm Hotel in Rodney Bay. Improving the quality of early childhood development services in St. Lucia continues to be a major priority as the Division of Education undertakes a program to upgrade daycare facilities on the island. Fennell Neptune tells us more.
The well-being of children of the nation is being promoted following the handing over of the Marigot Early Childhood Development Center in a ceremony held recently. Education Officer for Early Childhood Education, Agnes Prince, says the Division of Education remains committed to transforming the quality of early childhood services around the island.
We at the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, we are privileged to benefit from this project and anticipate compliance to standards in ensuring optimal development of children in this community in a safe and secure environment.
District 4 Education Officer Mary George Alice says she's extremely grateful for the investment made for the education of the nation's children.
This new learning environment is more child-friendly and has made allowance for the accommodation of more students and instructional equipment. The center can now boast of having many new initiatives, like the various specialized corners for drama, creative work, language, and manipulating, to name a few.
Parliamentary representative for Castries South, the Honorable Dr. Ernest Haler, says he is very satisfied with the refurbishment of the Early Childhood Development Center, which will shape the development of the children.
I am pleased that the facility is officially handed over to the community. I am pleased that it is going to become a central place for the learning of the next generation in this constituency. We look forward to how this facility can enhance the community and bring the community together. And I'm certainly looking forward, as the parliamentary representative, to continue to lend support to the center and to assist in whatever way I can to make sure that it is a success.
The Caribbean Development Bank, through its Basic Needs Stress Fund program, provided funding to refurbish the Marigot Early Childhood Development Center. From the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, I am Fennell Neptune reporting.
We now continue the broadcast with Everyday People.
Meet Antonia Joseph. She is the principal of the Donata School and Vocational Center, an institute for children with special needs. She taught at the school for 6 years before becoming the principal, a position she has held for the last 3 years.
At first, I did a degree in psychology, and I guess because I used to watch so much Law and Order, I thought that I would become a criminal psychologist. But through studying, I noticed that there are vulnerable individuals who would need my help a lot more. So I branched out into educational psychology, where I got a lot more understanding of our kids with special needs. So then I decided to go into it, and then it became a passion, right? So I stayed where my passion lied.
Miss Joseph is no stranger to this field.
Before Donata School, I lectured in Trinidad, where I studied. So I lectured A-level psychology, sociology. I also taught social studies, more or less the social sciences and behavioral sciences.
Miss Joseph says she felt right at home when she took up the responsibility of being a teacher first and then as the school's principal.
At Donata School, from the time I came in to the school to work, I felt that I needed to be here for a reason. I felt that I could improve things. To me, I think that you should be a part of an organization, always leave it better than when you came in. I realized that I was good at working with the students as a teacher, and also I did not remain in the classroom. I worked with parents, forming support groups for them, especially like the Autistic Society. We formed that. Then we branched out into the Down syndrome group. So it was beyond just the classroom and actually interacting with the community, right? So I think that it's a calling.
The school faces many challenges, she says, and she is calling on anyone desirous of making a contribution to the institution to do so.
We have many challenges at Donata School. For one, we are operating from 2 locations, so we know finance is a major challenge. Apart from that, we face the challenge of not having enough professionals to work along with the students. We need a speech and language therapist, physiotherapist, occupational therapist. We do not have many on island, and there are not enough opportunities for individuals who are in the field to actually go study and to contribute back to special ed. So we have those challenges to face with. The feeding program. Oh, every day we feed every student, whether or not they can afford. You cannot deny a child of a meal. It's always it's a great financial cost. It's always almost like, I don't want to say burden, but it is a great task to ensure that the kids not only are fed every day, but they get something healthy. You don't want to resort to a flour and rice diet. You want to get the vegetables, all of that in. We do get some help from Corporate St. Lucia. Some of the parents, when they can, they may contribute. However, a lot of what we do is in kind from strangers as well. So we try every day.
Assistance of any sort will be greatly appreciated.
Anyone out there who wants to assist Donata, so we take in any assistance that you're willing to give, whether it is the feeding program, whether it is volunteering your time, whether it's financial contribution, everything goes back to the students. So anything that you can give to the school, it is not wasted. It's a blessing to a child out there. It's a blessing to the most vulnerable individuals out there.
Miss Joseph says her teachers and students are all like family to her.
Well, we have a good relationship. I think for you to be working in this sector, it's more or less like a family, right? So when I interact with teachers and with students, I see my students as my family, my kids. The teachers as brothers and sisters that we are assisting, you know, in raising the most vulnerable.
For Everyday People, I am Alex Busquet.
Encouraging solutions to adopt healthy lifestyles. We'll tell you more when we come back. Welcome back to the DBS News World. Organizers of the Let's Move St. Lucia Challenge say they are happy with the response to the competition and are preparing to bring the curtains down on the challenge in the next few days. The initiative is designed to encourage St. Lucians to adopt more active lifestyles by walking 10,000 steps per day. At the end of this month, prizes will be awarded to individuals and workplaces who have accumulated the most steps. Alex Buske reports.
The aim of the Let's Move St. Lucia Challenge is to get people to walk 10,000 steps per day, but a few persons have surpassed that number.
Right now in the personal challenge, the person who's number one has over 1 million steps. And we have the company's challenge. Right now we have Grant Thornton and Ministry of Justice, who are the top two, and they're battling for the first place. Now, how you can measure your steps, basically we have a platform called Challenge Runner, and on Challenge Runner people have to enter their steps, which they measure by using a fitness tracker like this. So it measures the amount of steps that you do every day. You enter it on Challenge Runner. Challenge Runner has a leaderboard where we can see everybody's steps, and you can see who's in the lead and who you need to be working to beat. And so that way it's been a very exciting challenge, and it's been motivating many St. Lucians to get more active and to get out there and exercise far more than they used to do.
Staff at the Ministry of Justice found time during their work schedule to accumulate steps at a rapid pace. That would put them in a much better position to find themselves in a top spot in the challenge. Rani Harris, who works with the Ministry of Justice, is presently at third place in the individual challenge. The ministry is now in first place in the workplace challenge. Harris says the challenge has changed his life.
This competition has been very exciting. I love the challenges. I mean, from the time I hit first, this lady Samina would put me back at third place, and Sayers would put me back fourth place, you know, and it's a competition ongoing. Honestly, this competition have a huge impact on my life presently. I can tell you I'm never the one to be involved in sports or anything like that, but I always knew that I had the stamina to do stuff like that. And now I actually see what I can do with the stamina and the energy I have. I'm really pushing to win this competition.
The Let's Move St. Lucia Challenge will come to an end on June 30th. So far, in the individual challenge, Jason Sayers is in first place, Samina Sipal in the second place, and Rani Harris in third. In the workplace challenge, the Ministry of Justice is in first place, Grant Thornton in second place, and Slaspa in third place. The grand prize is $1,000, and other prizes, including dinners at various hotels, are up for grabs. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
The Castries East Home Health Caregivers will be hosting a health fair on Sunday at the Marshall Grounds. The event is a collaboration between the St. Lucia Social Development Fund, SSDF, and the Ministry of Health.
For example, we have incorporated the PSA and the PAPSME for ladies and the PSA for men. Now, we know men are very frightened of this, but no need to fear. The ladies, our nurses, not only our caregivers, our nurses in particular, are going to be taking very good care of you when it comes to that part of it. This particular one will be done by Mr. Gill from Global Lab. Also with us will be the Cuban doctors for the optical eye check. I think something like about 5 or 6 of them will be with us on that day to assist in making sure that Castries East community members have better sight. So they will be referring them, if it's necessary, they will be referred to the hospital for further check. We have also invited the Red Cross to be with us, and NEMO. These are agencies dealing with emergencies. Red Cross in particular, there are so many accidents these days, so many things happening, even in homes and so on, children losing their lives. Red Cross is going to be on site to assist in teaching us how to administer some critical first aid. And they will also be registering individuals for the first aid course. So we are inviting persons to come in and to be part of that. Well, the list goes on. There's HIV testing and the like.
A variety of free tests and health checks will be offered to the public.
We said massive because it's more than just checking the vitals and maybe checking your faculties like your vision and your air and your eye. We have also incorporated things like exercise. In fact, the program will be beginning with special exercises, aerobics, jazzercise, with one of the best in St. Lucia, or I would say the Caribbean, Velda. She's going to be there from 9 to 10 to do some special exercises, aerobics, with all attendees. Now, I said all because in spite of the fact that we have said Castries East, we want to invite the environs, we want to invite, if you're from Viewfort and you want to come down, that's fine. Come and enjoy the time with us. Some of what we will be having on site, as I mentioned, the exercise with Velda. We are also going to be having an element of the 10,000 step challenge. You may have heard of it from Let's Move St. Lucia. As a matter of fact, the group Let's Move St. Lucia has given us a gift of a fitness track for the day that will be at stake for individuals who will be able to master the challenge.
There will also be special activities for children. Parents are asked to walk with their children's health cards. Staff at the St. James Club Morgan Bay Resort and Spa got to show off their talents recently when the hotel held its annual talent show and competition. Here is Alex Buske with the details.
The June 16th event was organized by the resort's Staff Welfare Committee. It is based on the hotel's philosophy that happy employees are healthier and more productive.
Well, the staff committee, we look into aspects of the staff itself, how to make, it's not all about work, it's all about play and fun as well, and that aspect of the job, the Staff Welfare Committee takes care of that.
The annual event once again proved that the resort has a wide range of gifted performers among its staff members. Over 30 employees came together to put on 18 acts. The event drew an enthusiastic crowd of hotel staff and guests as employees displayed a variety of talents over three rounds of competition.
Regardless whatever department, some you get departments with one act, some have two. So the first one, we will go for all the departments, and the second one, we'll continue the other departments.
Okay, and the third was the drag.
How
was that?
That was the most captivating moment. Everyone was thrilled. Everything was just great about it.
Camillus Roseman was the overall winner of the competition, which has become very popular among guests. So much so, they've requested that the resort consider hosting it more than once a year. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
In some entertainment news, the host of DBS's This Morning Show, Sheila Mendez, has made a contribution to the 2018 Carnival season. This morning, during the BPM block party mix on Radio Caribbean International, Miss Mendez, popularly known as Purple Haze, released her first soca track, Mess.
It is just really the enjoyment of Carnival. We're coming out to make a mess. It was written by myself, Peter Wildfire Noel, and Irvin Ace Lochter. And it really is just encouraging people to have fun, have a good time, to free up. It's good, clean fun, though, and just a lot of good vibes. It's my first release ever. It's been in the pipeline, but just fulfilling a personal goal and happy that it's out. So, St. Lucia, enjoy it, feel it, vibe with it, and be part of the movement Purple Haze for Days.
While the release of the song has been a while in the making, the artist says she has no desire to enter any of the competitions.
All my legendary ladies, let me hear you sing. We dirty and we wassy, cause we comfy take the ting. We oiled on them not ready, cause we comfy have a ball. But when it comfy wassy, we go take over the town. Oh, miss, we walking up now, we walking up brave. The girl them with the wire, we see waste. Listen out for it, miss.
Based on the response to a new release, Mendez says she will decide whether to release another song. Quite a multi-talented individual, and congratulations to you, Sheila. A team of under 15 cricketers who graduated from the Darren Sammy Cricket Academy have all been equipped with cricket kits in preparation for upcoming tournaments. Don Nicholas reports the closing ceremony took place this afternoon.
The Darren Sammy Cricket Academy was launched in April. Its objective is to develop under 15 cricketers. Mr. Sammy says he was impressed with the level of talent on display. With the assistance of overseas partners, the organizers were able to ensure that all the graduates received cricket kits. The former test cricketer hopes that the young cricketers will go on to play at the highest level.
I did promise the youngsters for the hard work and dedication. You know, cricket cannot be played without equipments. And one of my goals was to make sure every child, every cricketer gets a full cricket kit.
Fellow St. Lucian cricketer John Eugene and other West Indian cricketers spearheaded the academy.
Guys, I challenge you to take care of the equipment. It's important that you take care of the equipment to better your performances. Whenever you use the equipment, it must be an opportunity to better your game, better your skills. Okay, it's a great opportunity for everyone.
Main sponsor Digicel is proud to be associated with the academy.
4 months ago, actually, in February, we'd have sat in a similar room, and it was a concept at the time. It was more of a dream, and it was trying to bring that to reality. And part of that was to ensure that persons actually had a kit, and we had long conversations on how we'd facilitate that. Fast track to actually doing the 4 days where Phil was with us, and Digicel was extremely happy with how the 4 days panned out. It gave us a little bit of insight, and we actually did the CPL Cricket Youth Academy. And it kind of begs itself to where Digicel is going in terms of cricket development, in terms of youth development.
The closing ceremony took place at the Harbour Club. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Welcome back. Time now for the usual reminder. A lack of political will is being blamed for the lack of progress in efforts to get St. Lucia to decriminalize marijuana. OECS has looked toward Africa as a trade partner. The Ministry of Health appeals to more St. Lucians to donate blood, and a former chief medical officer calls on the authorities to institute a strategy to reduce accidents caused by drunk driving. And that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening. Rick Wayne is on tonight at 8:30 right here on DBS Television with Talk. Goodbye.